Good morning all. This is the 20th lecture of the lecture series in statistical mechanics. This lecture onwards, we will discuss quantum statistical mechanics. When it comes to quantum mechanical systems composed of indistinguishable particles, it will be better to rewrite the ensemble theory in a language that is more natural to quantum mechanical treatment. That is the language of wave functions and operators. In this lecture, I will explain the concept density matrix. Before that, I will just mention about the notion of probability in quantum mechanics as well as in statistical mechanics. In quantum mechanics, we can only make probabilistic predictions about measurement outcomes. While in statistical mechanics, the system may be in any one of the possible microstates compatible with a particular microstate, and we can find probability for finding the system in a particular microstate. So in both quantum mechanics as well as in statistical mechanics, there is notion of probability. So I will first explain what is the meaning of these probabilities. So in quantum mechanics, we have wave functions as well as operators. For an observable A associated with a physical property, we can write the eigenvalue equation as A acting on phi n is equal to lambda n phi n. Here, this lambda n's are called eigenvalues and these phi n's are called eigenfunctions of the operator A. Now, a wave function in general can be expanded in terms of a set of orthonormal functions phi n. That is, if the state is a superposition state, we can expand the wave function in terms of a set of orthonormal functions. The orthonormal functions are defined as the ones with inner product equal to delta ij. That is, integral phi I star phi j d tau is equal to delta ij. This star means conjugate of phi I. Okay? If this condition is satisfied, we can say that these phi's are orthonormal functions. Now, consider a superposition state psi equal to a1 phi 1 plus a2 phi 2. That is, it is a mixed state. Phi 1 and phi 2 are two orthonormal functions. A1 and A2 are some constants. If this wave function is a normalized wave function, then we can write the inner product with itself is equal to unity. That is, integral psi star psi d tau equal to 1. If you substitute for psi from this expression and taking inner product, we can see that this result will give you modulus A1 square plus modulus A2 square is equal to 1. Okay, just substitute for this psi and take the inner product and use this identity of orthonormal functions. We will get this expression mod A1 square plus mod A2 square is equal to 1. Now, a measurement of property A in a particular state psi is A acting on psi is equal to A acting on psi is now A1 phi 1 plus A2 phi 2. Since phi 1 and phi 2 are the eigenfunctions of operator A, I can write this as A1 lambda 1 phi 1 plus A2 lambda 2 phi 2. Now, it is not possible to take a constant outside and write it like constant times psi. It is not possible to write A acting on psi is equal to a constant times psi. That is, it is not in the format of an eigenvalue equation. So, this wave function psi is not an eigenfunction of operator A. Phi 1 and phi 2 are eigenfunctions of operator A, but psi is not an eigenfunction of operator A. Then, we can find the expectation value of the variable A in the state psi and it is defined as expectation value equal to integral psi star a psi d tau. Integral psi star a psi d tau. Substituting for psi and using the orthonormal nature of the waveform, these functions phi 1 and phi 2, we can obtain an expression for expectation value, and that will be this lambda 1 into modulus a1 square. This integral phi 1 star phi 1 d tau will be 1. Then the other term will be modulus of a2 square multiplied with lambda 2. The cross terms will vanish. Expectation value is lambda 1 mod a1 square plus lambda 2 mod a2 square. That means measurement of the property a in state psi can either give a value lambda 1 with the probability mod a1 square, or it can give a value lambda 2 with the probability mod a2 square. We can say like this because in statistics we studied that if a variable x can have a value xi with the probability pi, then the mean value or average value of that quantity is x bar is equal to sum over all the possible values xi pi with the total probability equal to 1. That is, this variable x will take any one of the value xi. Total probability is 1. This is the mean value of that quantity. In a similar manner, here the expectation value of that variable A is lambda 1 mod A1 square plus lambda 2 mod A2 square. We can say that the measured outcome will be lambda 1 with the probability mod A1 square, and measured outcome will be lambda 2 with the probability mod A2 square. After measurement, if the outcome is lambda 1, we can say that the superposition state psi collapsed to phi 1, and if after measurement the value is lambda 2, we can say that after measurement the superposition state psi collapsed to phi 2. Okay. So for getting lambda 1 there is some probability, for getting lambda 2 there is some probability. We cannot say in advance what will be the outcome. Okay, so this is the probabilistic notion in the case of quantum mechanics. Now coming to statistical mechanics, system have many copies of same states. Let there be n1 copies of state phi 1 and n2 copies of state phi 2. Okay, suppose there are two different states and there are n1 copies of the same state phi 1 and n2 copies of the same state phi 2. The probability of obtaining a particular state phi 1 is n1 divided by total number of states n1 plus n2, and probability of obtaining state phi 2 is n2 divided by n1 plus n2. The total probability will be the sum of these two and it will be 1. Now consider a comparison. In quantum mechanics, we have the superposition state psi, which is a1 phi 1 plus a2 phi 2. There is only one state, so selection of state is completely deterministic. And once we have the state, we can do the measurement, and this measurement on the state psi can either give a value lambda 1 or it can give a value lambda 2. For getting lambda 1, we have a probability mod a1 square. For getting lambda 2, we have a probability mod a2 square. So this measurement step is completely probabilistic in the case of quantum mechanics. Selection state is completely deterministic. Coming to statistical mechanics, here the system consists of copies of mixture of phi 1 and phi 2. Again, we have two states, phi 1 and phi 2, but there are the number of copies of phi 1 and the number of copies of phi 2. Selection of a particular state is probabilistic. We can get state phi 1 with probability n1 divided by n1 plus n2. We can get a state phi 2 with the probability n2 divided by n1 plus n2. So the selection is probabilistic. Once we selected phi 1, the measurement will give you lambda 1. Once we selected phi 2, the measurement will give lambda 2. That is, the measurement step is completely deterministic. So here the selection step is probabilistic. Measurement step is deterministic. And with this of quantum mechanics, selection of state is deterministic, but the measurement is probabilistic. So this is the difference between the notion of probability in quantum mechanics and statistical mechanics. Now I will discuss about the topic density metrics. Quantum mechanical ensemble theory, the density metrics. Consider an ensemble of n identical systems with n very much greater than 1. Let the systems are characterized by a Hamiltonian H cap. All the systems will be characterized by same Hamiltonian because the systems are identical. And let psi k represents the state of kth system in the ensemble. K can take values 1, 2, etc. up to n. Now we want to find the time evolution of psi k, and that is given by Schrodinger equation. It is h cap psi is equal to I h cut dou by dou t of psi. Dou by dou t of psi, I will represent it as psi dot. So this becomes I h cut psi dot is equal to h cap psi. Now let there exist a complete set of orthonormal functions phi n. Then we can expand the wave function psi k in terms of these orthonormal functions. A n k t are the expansion coefficients, and since these phi n's are orthonormal, the inner product integral phi n star phi m d tau will be delta n m. If n equal to m, you will get it as 1, otherwise it will be 0. In order to find out the expansion coefficients a and k, we can take the inner product of psi k with phi m. That is, integral phi m star psi k d tau is equal to integral phi m star into substitute for psi k from equation 2, that is sigma n a n k phi n d tau. This summation and integration can be interchanged. So this becomes summation n integral a n k phi m star phi n d tau. This a n k can also take outside. Then the remaining is integral phi m star phi n d tau, and that is nothing but delta m n. Now, summation over n a n k delta m n will be a m k t, because when you sum over all the possible values of n, this delta m n has non-zero value only when m equal to n. Then all the n will get replaced with m. That is why this right hand side becomes a m k of t. So we obtain an expression for the expansion coefficients a m k, and it is equal to integral phi m star psi k d tau. Call this as equation number 3. Now, the physical state of a system can be either represented by the wave function psi k or by the components a and k. This is exactly similar to the representation of a vector by its components. Suppose you have a vector A, which is represented in a basis, in an orthonormal basis. Suppose the unit vectors are e1 cap, e2 cap and e3 cap. The vector can be represented as a1 e1 cap plus a2 e2 cap plus a3 e3 cap. And here the components a1, a2, a3 can be used to represent this vector A. In a similar fashion, we can use a and k to represent the state of a system. Now, we are going to calculate the time variation of a and k. Multiply with an ih cut, we will obtain I h cut dou by dou t of a n k is equal to I h cut into dou by dou t, substitute for a n k from equation number 3, that is this equation. So this becomes dou by dou t of integral psi n star psi k d tau. But I h cut, this dou by dou t you can take into outside, take into the inside of integral, then this becomes dou by dou t of psi k of t. That is nothing but psi dot. This phi n's are independent of t. So that becomes I h cut into integral phi n star psi dot d tau. What is I h cut psi dot? I h cut psi dot is nothing but h cap psi. From Schrodinger equation, I h cut psi dot is h cap psi. So again you can substitute for psi. Psi is sigma m a m k phi m in terms of the orthonormal functions. Now again this integration and summation can be interchanged, so that becomes summation m and integral phi n star h cap phi m d tau, call it as h n m. Or this integral will give you the nth element of the operator h cap. So I h cut a dot n k becomes equal to sigma m h n m a m k. Call this as equation number 4. And the definition of h n m, integral phi n star h cap phi m d tau, call it as equation number 5. Now from equation 2, that is psi k is equal to sigma a n k phi n, we can see that this a n k are probability amplitudes for the various systems of ensemble to be in the various states phi n. This is the definition from quantum mechanics. And modulus of a n k square represents the probability that a measurement at time t finds the kth system to be in the state phi n. There are n systems in the ensemble, and a11 mod square will give you the probability that a measurement at time t finds the first system to be in the state phi 1. Okay. Now, all the systems should be in any one of the state phi n's. That means if you sum over all the possible phi n's, a n k mod square, you will get 1. That is, the system should be in any one of the state phi n. Okay. Systems should be in any one of the state phi n. So if you add the probability, the total probability should be 1. Call this as equation number 6. Now I will define density operator. The density operator rho cap has mnth element rho mn of t is equal to 1 by n sigma k equal to 1 to n amk ank star. This term inside curly bracket, we will take the average of that quantity over the systems of ensemble. So this is an ensemble average of the quantity inside this curly bracket. And this amk ank star will vary from member to member in the ensemble. Depending on the value of k, this quantity in the curly bracket will vary. And you calculate this quantity for all systems in the ensemble and then sum over all the systems and then divide with the number of systems. You will get an ensemble average of this quantity. If you take the diagonal element, that is just put m equal to n, then you will get it as rho nn of t is equal to 1 by n sigma k equal to 1 to n. This becomes ank ank star. That becomes mod ank square. Mod ank square. So rho nn t represents probability of a system chosen at random from ensemble at time t is found to be in the state phi n. If you have just ank mod square, that is probability of finding the kth system in a state phi n. And here you are taking the average of that quantity over the entire systems in the ensemble. So this quantity rho nn is the probability that a system chosen at random to be found in the state phi n. Okay. Now, if you sum over rho nn over all these eigenstates, sigma n rho nn, you will get summation n. Rho nn is 1 by capital N, sigma k equal to 1 to capital N, mod ank whole square. You can interchange these summations. So, this becomes 1 by n, sum over k and sum over n, mod ank whole square. And sum over n mod ank whole square is 1. Okay, as per equation number 6, this summation will give you 1. So, I will get it as 1 by n into sum over k 1. And this summation runs over all the members of the ensemble. So, you will get 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus etc. up to capital N once. So, that will give you a capital N in the numerator. And that will cancel with this denominator and you will get it as 1. So, sigma n rho nn is equal to 1. Call this as equation number 8. What is the meaning of this? Rho nn is actually the diagonal element of density matrix. And sum over all values of n means the trace of density matrix. Okay. So, the left hand side actually represents the trace of density matrix. Trace is nothing but the sum of diagonal elements. Rho nn are the diagonal elements and taking sum, you will get trace. So, trace of density matrix is 1. Now, we will derive equation of motion for rho mn. Multiply with an I h cut, you will get I h cut rho dot mn equal to I h cut into dou by dou t of rho mn. That is 1 by n sigma k equal to 1 to n amk ank star. You can take this dou by dou t inside. So, that becomes I h cut into 1 by n sigma k equal to 1 to n dou by dou t acting on the product of two functions amk and ank star. So, you can apply product rule. First, take the derivative of amk, that becomes amk dot, keep ank star t constant. Then plus take the derivative of second term, keeping the first term constant. That will give you I h cut amk of t ank star dot. Okay. Now, we already have these equations for the equation of motion for the expansion coefficients. I h cut amk dot is equal to sigma l hml alk. If you take the conjugate of this equation, that becomes minus I h cut and you take it for ank. Ank star dot is equal to conjugate of right hand side sigma l h star nl alk star t. So, you can substitute for this I h cut amk dot and I h cut ank star dot from these expressions. Then we will get 1 by n sigma k equal to 1 to n into sigma l hml alk into ank star of t minus, this minus sign is because this minus I, minus amk into sigma l hnl star alk star. But this Hermitian matrix or this Hamiltonian matrix is actually Hermitian, okay, or this operator, Hamiltonian operator is Hermitian. So, I can write H star NL as HLN. Okay. H star NL becomes HLN because this operator is Hermitian. So, that becomes sigma L HML rho LN T minus rho ML HLN. Okay. Here, we again use the definition of density matrix. This 1 by N sum over all the systems in the ensemble. ALK ANK star, this is nothing but rho LN and this second term is nothing but rho ML. Okay, that is why this expression. Now, I h cut rho dot MN is equal to this term, we can write this as h cap rho cap because this is a product of two matrices. This L is common, so you can write it as the mnth element of h cap rho cap and this is the mnth element of rho cap h cap. So, this right hand side can be written as H cap rho cap minus rho cap H cap mnth element. Okay. Now, if we write in terms of operator instead of elements, I can write the left hand side as I H cut rho cap dot is equal to this bracket we called as commutator bracket, commutator of H cap and rho cap. Okay, commutator of two operator H cap and rho cap is defined as H cap rho cap minus rho cap H cap. So rho cap dot is equal to this I H cut will go to the right hand side, that becomes 1 by I H cut, and I will write it in the reverse manner, rho cap H cap by putting a negative sign. Okay, we already have Lively equation from classical statistical mechanics, where rho is the density of representative points and dou rho by dou t is equal to minus Poisson bracket of rho with h. When we come to quantum mechanical systems, this Poisson bracket get replaced with the 1 by I h cut commutator bracket. Okay, so when we go from classical mechanics to quantum mechanics, the Poisson bracket will become commutator bracket. Now consider the case of stationary ensemble. If the systems in the ensemble is in equilibrium, the corresponding ensemble is called stationary. That is, rho dot mn becomes zero. That is the mathematical condition for stationary ensemble. And in the case of quantum mechanical systems, this is true only when rho cap and h cap commutes each other. Okay, if rho cap and h cap commutes each other, this commutator bracket becomes zero and rho dot becomes zero. Okay, so the condition for stationary ensemble is the commutator bracket of rho cap with h cap should be zero, and that is true only when rho cap is a function of h cap. Rho cap is a function of h cap, that I will show you in the classical case. If rho is a function of Hamiltonian, the Poisson bracket of rho with h will be, the definition of Poisson bracket is dou rho by dou q into dou h by dou p minus dou rho by dou p into dou h by dou q. Okay, where q and p are canonical coordinate and momentum. Now, if rho is a function of Hamiltonian, I can write dou rho by dou q as dou rho by dou h into dou h by dou q, and this dou h by dou p is here, minus dou rho by dou p, I can write it as dou rho by dou h into dou h by dou p. This dou h by dou q. These two terms are exactly equal, so the Poisson bracket becomes zero. So if rho is a function of h, Hamiltonian, Poisson bracket of rho with h will be zero. Okay, the quantum mechanical analog is, if rho cap is a function of h cap, the commutator of rho cap and h cap becomes zero. Now we will consider another case. That is, the basis functions phi n are eigenfunctions of Hamiltonian itself. Then I can write the eigenvalue equation for Hamiltonian operator as h cap phi n is equal to en phi n, where en is the energy eigenvalue. The nmth element of the Hamiltonian operator is hnm is equal to integral phi n star h cap phi m d tau. H cap phi m, I can write it as en em phi m. So this becomes integral phi n star em phi m d tau. So that is nothing but em into integral phi n star phi m d tau is delta nm. So h nm is equal to em delta nm. That means this has value only when n equal to m. That is, this matrix, the corresponding matrix for Hamiltonian operator will be diagonal. It has non-zero value only when n is equal to m. So h will be diagonal in the representation or energy representation. If the phi n's are eigenfunctions of Hamiltonian, that representation is called energy representation, and in the energy representation h will be diagonal. Now we know that h and rho commutes each other in the case of a stationary ensemble. If two operators commutes, they will have same set of eigenfunctions. I will prove that. you have h cap phi n is equal to en phi n, because phi n's are eigenfunctions of h cap. Now multiply with the rho cap. Rho cap h cap phi n is equal to rho cap into h cap phi n is en phi n. You can take en to the left side because en is just a number. So en into rho cap phi n. Since rho cap and h cap commutes, I can write rho cap h cap is equal to h cap rho cap. So instead of this rho cap h cap, I can write h cap into rho cap. So that becomes h cap acting on rho cap phi n is equal to en into rho cap phi n. What does it mean? This rho cap phi n is also an eigenfunction of the operator h cap, corresponding to the same eigenvalue en. For an operator, if we have two sets of eigenfunctions, they will be proportional. That is, I can write rho cap phi n proportional to phi n, because rho cap phi n and phi n both are eigenfunctions of same operator corresponding to the same eigenvalue, then they should be proportional. So we can replace this proportionality with a constant. So rho cap phi n is equal to, let me denote this constant as rho n. So this is similar to an eigenvalue equation with phi n as eigenfunctions and rho n as the eigenvalue. And this is eigenvalue equation for the operator rho cap or the density operator. So this equation means that the density operator also have the same set of eigenfunctions. Okay. So if Hamiltonian has the eigenfunctions phi n, and Hamiltonian and the density matrix commutes each other, that implies this density matrix will also have the same set of eigenfunctions. So if I take the nth element of density matrix, rho nm equal to integral phi n star rho cap phi m d tau. Rho cap phi m is rho m phi m. Rho m can take outside. Integral phi n star phi m d tau is nothing but delta nm. That is rho nm equal to rho m delta nm. That is, density matrix is also diagonal. So in energy representation, both h cap and rho cap will be diagonal. Okay, this is an important property. In the energy representation, both Hamiltonian matrix and or Hamiltonian operator and the density operator will be diagonal. In any other representation, the density matrix may or may not be diagonal. Okay? In any other representation, the density matrix may or may not be diagonal. But in energy representation, density matrix will be diagonal. But in any representation, the density matrix is always symmetric. That is, rho mn is always equal to rho nm. Okay, in any representation that is true, rho mn equal to rho nm. Because at statistical equilibrium, the tendency of a system to switch from one state to the other must be balanced by an equally strong tendency to switch between the same states in the reverse direction. If you have two states, then the probability of transition from first state to second state is exactly equal to the probability of transition from second state to the first state. So rho mn and rho nm will be the same. Okay. Now we will calculate the expectation value of a quantity. Suppose we have a quantity g, which is represented by the operator g cap. Then its expectation value, by the definition, it is expectation value of g is equal to, the usual definition is integral psi k star g cap psi k d tau. But in the case of ensemble, we should take the ensemble average. We should take the ensemble average. That is why this summation and divided by the total number of systems in the ensemble. Okay. The expectation value of g is given by 1 by n sigma k equal to 1 to n integral psi k star g cap psi k d tau. In terms of coefficient a and k, we can write this as, so we can write psi k in terms of expansion coefficient using this summation sigma n a n k star phi n star. This g cap, again psi k can be represented as sigma m a m k phi n. Okay, so you have a 1 by n here, sigma k equal to 1 to n. There are two summations, sigma m n, and this integral phi n star g cap phi m g tau. I can call it as gnm. That is nmth element of the operator g cap. Okay, the remaining is ank star and amk. So expectation value is given by the ensemble average of sigma mn ank star amk gnm, where gnm is integral phi n star g cap phi m g tau. The expectation value equal to sigma mn rho mn gnm, because this quantity 1 by n sigma k equal to 1 to n ank star amk is nothing but rho mn into gnm. So this n and this n are equal. The row of this matrix, the column of this and row of this are same. So you can take the product. This is nothing but the mmth element of matrix rho cap g cap. Okay. So this is sigma m rho cap g cap mmth element. Some mmth element means diagonal element. If you take the sum of diagonal elements, that is nothing but trace. That is nothing but trace. So the right hand side is trace of rho cap g cap. So this is a very important result. The expectation value of an observable g is trace of rho cap g cap, where g cap is the operator corresponding to that observable. Okay. If we take the g cap as identity operator I cap, then rho cap into I cap is you can denote it as one cap identity operator, then rho cap with identity operator will give you rho cap itself. So, and what is the expectation value of identity operator? That is 1. Okay, so that is 1 is equal to trace of rho cap. This result we already proved, the trace of density matrix is unity. Now, if the original wave functions psi k were not normalized, the expectation value is given by trace rho cap g cap divided by trace of rho cap. Okay, this is the procedure for finding the expectation value of a quantity in the ensemble in terms of density matrix. Now we will consider the three different types of ensemble, statistics of various ensembles. First, we will consider the microcanonical ensemble. In microcanonical ensemble, systems are characterized by a fixed number of particles, fixed volume, and energy vary only in a small range, E minus half delta to E plus half delta, where delta is very small compared to E. And the number of microstates, gamma, is a function of N, V, E, and delta. All the microstates are equally probable in the case of microcanonical ensemble, and it is known as equal a priori probability. In energy representation, we know that the density matrix is diagonal and the diagonal elements are respectively 1 by gamma for each accessible states and 0 for all other states. That is, the probability of finding the system in a particular microstate is given by 1 by gamma, because there are total gamma states and all the states are equally probable. So probability of finding the system in a particular state will be 1 by gamma. So rho n, the diagonal element, will be 1 by gamma for each accessible states. For all other states, it will be 0. The sum over all the diagonal elements, that is 1 by gamma plus 1 by gamma plus 1 by gamma, if you sum over all the states, you will get gamma by gamma, that will be 1. Okay, so the trace of density matrix is 1. Now, the thermodynamics of a system is governed by the equation S equal to K log omega, the famous Boltzmann entropy relation. S equal to K log omega. Now, if the quantum state is unique, that is, the system has only one state. If the system has only one state, gamma will be 1 and entropy will be 0. The case with the gamma equal to 1 is known as the pure case. Here, no need to consider the ensemble. Because ensemble approach is usually to visualize all possible microstates at a particular instant. If system changes its state with respect to time, and if it passes through different microstates, then in order to visualize all the states at a particular instant, we are using this ensemble approach. That is, we make a large number of identical copies of the systems, which are in all possible sorts of different microstates. Okay, here there is only one state, so no need to consider the ensemble. So only one non-zero diagonal element, which is equal to unity, all others are zero. Okay, if gamma is equal to 1, then you will have only one non-zero diagonal element, all other elements are zero. If you take rho square, if you multiply this matrix with itself, then you will get the rho itself. Okay, you can check it. You multiply this matrix with itself, then the resultant will be the same matrix. Okay, that is rho square is equal to rho. If a matrix satisfies this condition, it is known as idempotent matrix. It is known as idempotent matrix. So density matrix is idempotent. That is another feature of density matrix. It will be idempotent. In any other representation, this density matrix may not be diagonal. Then the general definition is rho mn equal to 1 by n sigma k equal to 1 to n amk t ank star t. But we are considering the pure case. That means all the systems in the ensemble are in the same state, because there is only one state. That is the meaning of pure case. So all the systems in the ensemble are in the same state. So if you sum over all the members of the ensemble, all will have identical values. So you will get n identical values divided by this n. You will get it as rho mn equal to amt an star t. Okay. So what is rho mn square? You multiply this. So rho mn square is sigma l rho ml rho ln. This is the product of two matrices. Rho ml rho ln will give you the mnth element of the matrix rho square. So substitute for rho ml. Rho ml is amt al star t. Rho ln is alt an star t. This sum over l al star al, that is nothing but sigma l mod al square, and that is equal to unity. That is equal to unity. So this is again amt an star t. Amt an star t is nothing but rho ml. So rho square mn is equal to rho mn. That is, density matrix is idempotent in any representation. Okay, it need not be the energy representation. In any representation, the density matrix is idempotent. Now, if we consider a case with the gamma greater than 1, it is known as a mixed case, because now there will be more than one state possible for the system. Okay, then it is known as a mixed state. If only one state is possible for the system, then it is called the pure case. If more than one state is allowed, then it is known as a mixed case. Then the density matrix in energy representation is again diagonal. Rho mn is equal to rho n delta mn, rho n delta mn, with rho n is equal to 1 by gamma for accessible states and 0 for other states. Okay, here gamma is greater than 1. So if gamma is 2, it will be diagonal with the two diagonal entries as 1, 1 by 2 and 1 by 2, not 1. The diagonal entries will be 1 by 2 and 1 by 2. If there are 3 states, that is gamma equal to 3, then the density matrix will be diagonal with the 3 diagonal elements are 1 by 3, 1 by 3, 1 by 3, and all other elements will be 0, like that. Now, in any other representation, this is for energy representation, in any other representation, to ensure that all diagonal elements should continue to be zero and diagonal elements should continue to be equal to one another, we need two postulates. Okay, in all representations, the off diagonal elements will be zero and diagonal elements will be the same. But in energy representation, it is straightforward. But in any other representation, in order to ensure these two things, we need two postulates. Okay, The first one is postulate of random a priori faces. The second one is postulate of equal a priori probability. What is the meaning of postulate of random a priori faces? That is, this A and K can be written as some magnitude A into a phase factor E raised to I theta and K. And random phase means for each A and K, this phase will be different. Magnitude will be same, but the phase will be different. Phase varies randomly. Okay. So A and K can be written as A into E raised to I theta and K. This is actually polar representation. Now, psi K will be an incoherent superposition of the basis phi N. Because psi K, you can write it as some A and K phi N. Since A and Ks are having different phases, this psi K can be considered as an incoherent superposition of the basis. What about rho Mn? Rho Mn is equal to ensemble average of AMK, ANK star, and that is 1 by N sigma K equal to 1 to N. Both this have the same magnitude, and that will give you mod A square. In the phase factor is E raised to I theta MK minus theta NK. Why this minus sign? Because the second is conjugate. If you take the conjugate, this becomes minus I. So, rho Mn is equal to mod A square, you can take outside. Then the ensemble average of this quantity, E raised to I theta MK minus theta NK. If M equal to N, this becomes E raised to 0, and that is 1. So, if M equal to N, you will get mod A square, a constant value. If M not equal to N, the average value of E raised to I theta MK minus theta NK will be 0. For any value of M and N which are not equal, this average will be 0. If M equal to N, this average will be 1. Okay, so we can say that this density matrix will be again diagonal, and all the diagonal elements are same, which is mod A square. This mod A square. So rho Mn is equal to mod A square delta Mn. When M is not equal to N, this quantity average will be 0. Otherwise, this average will be 1. So rho Mn is again diagonal, and diagonal elements are all equal. Diagonal elements are equal. Okay. So to secure the physical situation corresponding to microcanonical ensemble, we require two postulates. Postulate of equal a priori probability and postulate of random a priori phases. Okay. And the second one, the postulate of random a priori phases, arises solely from quantum mechanics and is intended to ensure the non-interference among number systems. Okay, among number systems. Now, we will consider the case of canonical ensemble. Here, systems are characterized by fixed number of particles, fixed volume, and fixed temperature. Energy is now a variable. So, we will calculate the probability that a system in the ensemble possesses an energy ER. This probability is determined by the Boltzmann factor E raised to minus ER by KT, or it is equal to E raised to minus beta ER, where beta is 1 by KT. In energy representation, the density matrix is diagonal, and it is given by rho Mn is equal to rho N delta Mn, with rho N is equal to C E raised to minus beta En, because rho N is a measure of probability. And in the case of canonical ensemble, the probability is determined by the Boltzmann factor E raised to minus beta En or beta ER. Now, the total probability should be 1. So, applying normalization, we will get C is equal to 1 divided by sigma E raised to minus beta En. This sum over all microstates E raised to minus beta En is known as partition function of the system. And for an n-particle system, it is represented as Qn of beta. Okay, this is n-particle partition function. Therefore, I can write rho Mn is equal to E raised to minus beta En divided by sigma E raised to minus beta En delta Mn. Okay, so the density matrix is again diagonal. Since the density matrix is diagonal, these phi n's are eigenfunctions of rho cap also. So rho cap phi n is equal to rho n phi n. This equation we already discussed. And in terms of the ket notation, we can write it as rho cap acting on phi n is equal to rho n acting rho n into phi n. Taking the outer product, we will get sigma n rho cap phi n outer product with phi n is equal to sigma n rho n phi n with phi n. This rho n you can take inside, so the right hand side becomes sigma n phi n rho n phi n. The left hand side, sigma n phi n outer product with phi n, that is the unity operator. So rho cap multiplied with the unity operator will give you rho cap itself. So rho cap is sigma n phi n. Instead of rho n, we can write this value e raised to minus beta e n divided by sigma e raised to minus beta e n. That is nothing but the partition function q n of beta n bra phi n. Okay. So this is equal to sigma n. You can write this as e raised to minus beta h cap acting on phi n. Okay. E raised to minus beta h cap acting on phi n. Since h cap is Hermitian operator, it can act on either side. So I can write this as sigma n phi n with phi n is again identity operator. So this becomes rho cap is equal to e raised to minus beta h cap divided by qn of beta. Qn of beta is nothing but trace of this matrix e raised to minus beta h cap. Okay. So this is the density matrix in the case of canonical ensemble. Now, what is the meaning of exponential of an operator e raised to minus beta h cap? This the definition is same as exponential of a variable. It is sigma j equal to 0 to infinity. Due to this negative sign, you will have a minus 1 raised to j beta h cap raised to j divided by j factorial. Okay, the definition is same as that of exponential of a variable. Instead of variable, you have now a matrix. So when you expanding 1 plus x, instead of 1, you have to write identity operator. Okay, that is the only difference. Now, expectation value of a quantity g, we can represent it as g suffix n. This suffix means the number of particles is fixed and it is n. G suffix n, the expectation value, it is equal to, by definition, it is trace of rho cap g cap. And here rho cap is e raised to minus beta h cap divided by qn beta. Qn beta is a number, you can take it outside. So this becomes trace of g cap e raised to minus beta h cap. Now qn beta, we can write it as trace of e raised to minus beta h cap. So expectation value of g is trace of g cap e raised to minus beta h cap divided by trace of e raised to minus beta h cap. Now we will consider the third ensemble, that is the grand canonical ensemble. Here only the volume is fixed, both number of particles as well as energy is variable. So the density operator rho cap operates on a Hilbert space with an indefinite number of particles. Number of particles is a variable. So rho cap will commute with h cap, the Hamiltonian operator, which corresponds to the different energy values, as well as the number operator n cap, which corresponds to the variable number of particles. The number operator n cap has eigenvalues 0, 1, 2, etc. The procedure for finding the density matrix is exactly same as that of canonical ensemble. The only difference is there is an added term. Okay. So rho cap is proportional to e raised to minus beta h cap minus alpha n cap. And I can write rho cap is equal to some constant into e raised to minus beta h cap minus alpha n cap. On normalization, we can find the value of c, and it is nothing but 1 divided by zeta, where zeta is grand partition function. In the case of canonical ensemble, the normalization factor was 1 by q, where q is partition function. Here for grand canonical ensemble, it is grand partition function. It is e raised to minus beta into minus beta, you can take outside. The remaining is h cap minus mu n cap, where mu is chemical potential and it is nothing but minus alpha by beta. So this theta, which is grand partition function, it is sum over all n, s and er values e raised to minus beta er minus alpha ns, or it is the trace of e raised to minus beta h cap minus mu n cap. Okay. Now the ensemble average of a quantity g is given by the expectation value g. It is equal to 1 by theta trace of g cap e raised to minus beta h cap minus mu n cap. In the case of canonical ensemble, the equation was expectation value g n suffix n, where number of particles was fixed, 1 by q trace g cap e raised to minus beta h cap. The difference is there is no suffix n because n is a variable and there is an added term. And this can be written as sigma n equal to 0 to infinity z raised to n expectation value g with fixed number of particles and qn of beta, this canonical partition function, divided by this grand partition function. I can write it as sigma n equal to 0 to infinity z raised to n qn of beta. Here z, it is nothing but e raised to beta mu. It is called fugacity of the system that we already discussed in the case of classical statistical mechanics also. And this g suffix n is the canonical ensemble average and theta is the grand partition function. Okay, so this is the procedure for finding an average value of a variable in the case of grand canonical ensemble. So in the next lecture, we will consider some examples for the application of density matrix for finding the average value of some physical quantities of the system. Thank you.